knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
In the previous tutorial, we learned about Fourier transforms and how they can be used to identify what frequencies are present in a function, and how they are especially useful for picking out the frequency components of sums of sine waves. We will now study the partial differential equation that models wave propagation, and that is the aptly named wave equation. The wave equation is a PDE that has the general form Laplacian of u equals 1 over c squared times the second partial derivative of u with respect to time. Recall that the Laplacian operator can be expressed as a sum of second partial derivatives with respect to position, which in 3D Cartesian coordinates are x, y, and z. So in the most general case, the wave equation is a PDE with four independent variables, x, y, z, and time t. We will initially focus on the 1D case of the wave equation, and that will be u x x equals 1 over c squared times u t t, where c is a constant representing the speed of the waves, and we can verify that the wave equation is a hyperbolic PDE, unlike the elliptic Laplace equation we looked at previously. We will show two ways to solve the wave equation, first using separation of variables, and second using Fourier transforms, both of which we covered in the previous tutorials. For separation of variables, we assume that our solution u of xt is the product capital X of x times capital T of t. Substituting in and separating the variables leads to two Sturm-Liouville problems, and if we choose negative lambda squared as our separation constant, we will get trigonometric solutions for each of x and t, which is usually going to be the better choice for describing waves. Without any boundary conditions, we can accept any value of lambda whatsoever, and the solution will be valid. Note that in the context of waves, it might be better to use the wave number k instead of lambda, since lambda is typically used to mean wavelength. For our function t of t, we can replace k times c with omega, which is the angular frequency of the wave. Note that k and omega are not independent. They are in a ratio defined by the wave speed c, which is a constant that was part of the original PDE. When multiplied together, the functions x and t correspond to traveling waves, which we can more easily see by using the product to sum trig identities. We can now interpret our solution as a wave in the x direction that has a time-dependent phase shift, always propagating through space at that fixed speed of c, which we will now call the phase velocity of the wave. If our boundary conditions are such that the wave is constrained to have nodes at fixed points, such as the ends of a vibrating string, then we could identify the allowable frequencies, which are known as normal modes in the context of vibrations, and sum over those, as shown here. We can also interpret our answer as a Fourier series, where the coefficients a and c are the terms of the Fourier series of some function of x plus or minus ct. The roots of these functions, which are the lines x plus or minus ct equals 0 when plotted in xt space, are called the characteristic lines of the wave, and these lines can be interpreted as the directions along which the information in the system can propagate. We should also note that if the conditions are such that we find the constants a and c to be equal, our solution becomes a standing wave, which does not propagate through space at all, instead oscillating with fixed nodes, or places with zero amplitude, and antinodes, or places with maximum amplitude. Next, let's compare this method to using Fourier transforms. We start with our wave PDE and take the Fourier transform with respect to the time domain. On the left, since the derivatives are with respect to x, which is not t, we just get the second derivative of the transform u hat with respect to x. On the right, we have 1 over c squared, and then the Fourier transform of a second derivative is I omega all squared times the transform. We can rearrange to get an ordinary differential equation in our transformed solution u hat, which is now a function of x, but is also parameterized by our frequency variable omega. In accordance with before, we can let k equal omega over c and solve the ODE to get our transform in terms of trig functions, which this time we will actually prefer using the complex exponential form of the complementary solution using Euler's formula. Note that the coefficients a and b will depend on omega and can be viewed as functions of omega. To take the inverse Fourier transform of this expression, we exploit the time shift property of the Fourier transform, which tells us that the transform of a function shifted in time is a complex exponential times the transform of the unshifted function. And using the duality property, we can express our solution as some general function f of t plus x over c, plus another general function g of t minus x over c, where these general functions f of t and g of t are the inverse transforms of our a and b functions of omega. This very generalized form of a wave solution is known as D'Alembert's solution, and it represents any wave as a superposition of a traveling wave going left and a traveling wave going right. If we now express our functions p and q as Fourier series, converting them to an infinite sum of sinusoids with a suitable fundamental frequency, we will recover precisely the same general solution as we found before. Let's see how the idea of harmonics comes in with the wave equation. Suppose that we have a taut guitar string of some fixed length L, and we pull the middle of the string out by some small distance h before letting it go at time t equals 0. Intuitively, the string should vibrate at the fundamental frequency of the string, producing a tone, but let's see what the math can tell us. We just need to take our general solution to the wave equation and use the initial condition u of x0 equals this triangle-shaped function, as well as partial u partial t equals 0 at t equals 0, which is a boundary condition that states that the string starts from rest. To do this, it will be easier to return to our separation of variables solution shown here. We can take the time derivative of this expression, substitute t equals 0, and set the whole thing to 0. The only option that doesn't result in the whole function always being 0, which we would call the trivial solution, is that all the dn's must be 0. Next, if we plug t equals 0 into our function, we can say that the resulting expression must be the Fourier series of our initial condition, which turns out to be this expression consisting only of sine terms in x. So we can set all the a_n's to 0 and all the b_n's to our Fourier series coefficients. This gives us our particular solution, and we can see that it is a sum of standing waves of odd integer multiples of the fundamental frequency, which means that this string will vibrate at all of these frequencies when released from its initial position. But if we observe that the factor at the front has the form 1 over n squared, we can see that not all of these vibrational modes will be excited in equal amounts, and indeed the higher frequency components will have much smaller amplitudes. This means that the guitar string will primarily produce the fundamental frequency by vibrating at the first mode, but it will also have some harmonics at higher frequencies, known as overtones, to complement the sound it produces, starting at 3 times the fundamental frequency for our initial condition. The actual value of that first fundamental frequency in hertz depends on the wave speed c via the formula f1 equals c over 2l. And for a pretensioned string, such as a guitar string, we can use physics to find that c is equal to the square root of the tension in the string t, divided by the mass per unit length of the string mu. The different strings on a guitar all have different thicknesses, which gives them different values of mu, and the musician can turn the tuning pegs at the neck of the guitar to vary the tensile force in the string T, allowing careful control of the wave speed on the string, and hence the fundamental frequency or pitch of the sound it produces. Let's check comprehension.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.